Well, good evening, my little children of the fright. Tis me, tis I, your old pal, the Collector. And welcome to another Friday Night Fable Fright, and a very cold welcome to all of my Fright followers joining me live on Instagram as I'm recording this video right now. Yes, that's right, I'm currently doing a live stream as I record this episode, and I may continue to do this every now and then. So be sure to join me over on Instagram at Old Pal Collector, so you don't miss out on your chance to hang out with your old pal. But now, let's get into tonight's tasty treat from my trenches of torturous tomes. We'll be getting back into the latest and greatest from my collection, Tales from the Crypt, Volume 1, with story adaptations from Eleanor Fremont and first published in 1991 by Random House. Tonight's story first appeared in issue number 24 of the original comic book series, published in 1951, and the tale that I'll be reading for you all tonight is Bats in My Belfry. Shall we begin? I first found out that I was going deaf when I visited our family doctor. I had gone to him because of a painful earache, but what he told me came as a complete surprise. "I'm sorry, Matt," he said. "I know what this will do to your career, but the symptoms are unmistakable. In a month or so, you'll be stone deaf." I was in shock. "Are you sure, Doc? Can't you do anything? Operate?" "No," he said sadly. "Nothing can be done for you. There is no operation." "I see," I said, though I really didn't see at all. "Well, thank you for everything, Doctor." I stumbled out of his office into the sunshine. I went home to my beautiful wife, Laura, and told her what the doctor had said. "You mean you won't be able to act anymore?" she asked me when I'd finished explaining as well as I could. "Well, how could I?" I said despairingly. "I'd miss my cues. My voice expression would be lost." Her voice rose. "Well, there must be something they can do. Go see specialists. Make sure." Even when she was this upset, Laura looked glamorous and lovely. She was wearing an expensive red silk dress cut very low, and she tossed her red hair as she spoke. I lived to make Laura happy. Sometimes it wasn't easy because she liked to live in high style. Only the best for Laura. But I didn't mind. I loved her as much as I had when we'd first married. I loved her to distraction. "I'll see another doctor, dear, I will," I promised. But every doctor I went to told me the same story. It was useless. When I started to miss my cues on stage, it was impossible to keep the awful secret anymore. "Sorry, Matt," the directors would say. "We'll have to get another star." "Huh?" I would respond. "What did you say?" And then at last, it came. The thick, heavy silence. I was stone deaf. I walked in a world of stillness. The traffic, the crowds, the orchestras in nightclubs, all silent. I had to learn to lip-read to understand what Laura said to me. "Our money's practically gone," she said to me one day. "Huh?" I said. She yelled into my face, moving her lips very slowly. "I said, our money's practically gone. Understand? We're broke, cleaned out. Get it?" "Yes, Laura," I said. Things got worse. I tried to find work, but I couldn't do anything. Acting was all I knew. Then I thought of an old friend, John Bain. John and I had played summer stock together. Then John had gone blind. I went to see him the next day. "Well, well," he chuckled as he opened his door. "Matt Gordon, it's good to see you." Did you say my name, John?" I faltered. I'm deaf, I can't hear you." "Did you say my name?" "Well, of course," he said slowly. "I recognized you immediately." "You can see? Then why do you wear dark glasses?" "To hide my eyes," he said, whipping off his sunglasses. "These eyes. Good Lord," I gasped. John's eyes gleamed yellow in the dim light of his room. They were the eyes of a cat. What did you do to yourself? "Your eyes," I began. "Yes," he said. "They're cat's eyes." "Huh?" I said. "They're cat's eyes," he shouted into my face. "But who cares, Matt? I can see." I had difficulty reading John's lips, but I managed to understand enough of what he said to get the whole story. And what a story it was. "I found out about him through another ex-blind man," John explained. "He's a genius. He operated on me, grafted these cat's eyes, and now I can see." Do you think he can help me, John? I asked, grabbing him by the shoulders. Can he restore my hearing the same way? Why don't you go see him, said John. Huh? I said. Go see him, shouted John. I'll give you his address. And so the next day found me in the shabbiest part of the city. The shop was on a dark and winding back street. There were animals, stuffed ones, in the dusty window. Monkeys, a fox, a hawk, a moose's head. John said he wasn't a doctor, I mused as I looked in. But this looks more like a taxidermist shop. I went in. The odor of staleness and decay hung heavily in the air. He came from behind a curtain. He was tall and dark, even sinister looking. You were recommended by a friend, I said nervously. What was I doing there? What had I gotten myself into? But I had no choice. He was my only hope. You helped him to see again, I continued. I wondered if... I can see by the way you watch my lips, you are deaf, he said. Huh? I said. Deaf, he shouted into my face. Come into the back. I will examine you. The rear of the shop looked like an alchemist's nightmare. There were bottles and jars of various colored liquids and powders. But in the center of the room was a modern-looking operating table with up-to-date equipment. He examined me briefly. I could hardly stand to have him near me. He smelled bad. Your auditory nerves are paralyzed, he said. I will have to replace your whole hearing system with something different. What do you have in mind? I asked nervously. I propose transferring the auditory system of a bat into your body. A bat? I was horrified. Yes, he said. The bat's auditory system is unique. It is extrasensory. If the operation is a success, you will be able to hear better than you did before you lost your hearing. I agreed to the operation. After all, what did I have to lose? When do we do it? I asked him. Now, he said. I lay down on his operating table. I was scared out of my wits. Breathe deep, Mr. Gordon, he said as he clamped the anesthesia mask over my face. The last thing I saw was his horrible, twisted smile. Then I blacked out. When I came out of the anesthesia, I looked around. He was standing over me. He started to speak. How do you feel? He asked. His voice slammed into my brain. It was harsh and loud. My head! Don't talk, I cried. You'll get used to it, Mr. Gordon, he said. I certainly hope so, I said, my face covered with sweat. But would I? Have you ever turned a radio up full blast right next to your ear? That's what everything sounded like to me as I made my way home. When I opened the door, I heard Laura's voice. She was upstairs on the phone. I think he just came in, she was saying. I'll have to hang up now, darling. Goodbye. Yes, of course, I love you. Oh dear. I could hear the rustle of her low-cut silk dressing gown as she hung up the phone. I couldn't believe it. Laura, and another man. I decided not to tell her about my good fortune, about my hearing being restored. I wanted to wait. I wanted to find out more. That night, I couldn't sleep. I got dressed and went for a walk. Funny, I thought as I shuffled along in the shadows of an alley. I have the strangest feeling, like I wanted to scream. I ignored the strange feeling and just kept walking. I guess I walked all night. When I returned home, Laura was gone. She had gotten a job since I lost my hearing, and she must have left early that morning. As I walked upstairs, I couldn't believe how tired I was. The sun was streaming through the windows. A heavy drowsiness had come over me, and I could hardly make it up the stairs. I had to go to sleep. What in the blazes, I cried as my eyes flew open. I didn't even remember falling asleep, but I woke to find myself in the clothes closet. I had fallen asleep, hanging upside down, from the clothes pole. What's happening to me? I said to myself as I slipped to the floor. I staggered into the bathroom and looked in the mirror. I needed a shave badly, but there was something else. Hair growing on my forehead, my nose, all over my face, fine gray hairs. I was frightened. I shaved carefully, clearing my face of the growth. Then I stepped into the shower. As I raised my arm to soap under it, I received a new shock. What the? I spluttered. There's a membrane growing across my armpit. It stretched from my side all the way over to my elbow, like some kind of disgusting wing. I dressed quickly and it wasn't easy getting my suit jacket on. I rushed to my friend John's house, John, who had first recommended the strange shop with its still stranger proprietor. It was getting dark outside. I burst through his door without knocking. John, I yelled, running through the rooms to look for him. Get out quickly, said a strange hoarse voice that sounded a bit like John's. His room was dimly lit. His feline eyes glowed with an eerie yellow light. He lay in a corner. White, picked, clean bones were strewn all around him. His face was covered with silky black fur. Get away from me before it's too late, he cried hoarsely. I'm an animal. What's happened? Tell me, I shouted. John stood up in a crouch. It's that horrible fiend, he said. He's done something to me. These aren't cat's eyes he's given me. They're the eyes of a panther. And I can't help myself. I have an incessant urge to kill. Lord help us, I gasped. John snapped on the light. Look at me! Look, he cried. I'm even beginning to look like a panther. Don't go to him, Matt. Don't! It's too late, John, I broke in. It's too late! John snarled. His eyes burned. I got out. I began to walk, thinking. That explains falling asleep hanging upside down in the closet, I said to myself. And the gray hairs on my face, and the membrane growing across my armpits. I'm turning into a bat! And that night, as I walked through the blackness, I began to utter short, shrill shrieks, and I listened for the shrieks to echo back. I was using sonar, the radar-like device bats use for traveling through darkness. When dawn came, I made my way home. Where have you been all night? Snapped Laura. Can you understand me? Why did you stay out all night? I got a job, Laura, I said, loosening my tie. I was exhausted. I had to sleep. I kept my face turned away from her so she wouldn't see how strange I looked. You got a job? She said, rolling up her silk stockings. Good, then I'll quit mine today. If you like, Laura, I said wearily. I'm going to bed. She went out, and I lay exhausted on the bed. Again, I don't remember falling asleep, but when I awoke, I was hanging upside down in the closet. I opened my eyes and heard voices. Laura's voice, and a man's, coming from downstairs. He carried a large insurance policy, Laura was saying. $100,000. He took it out while he was acting and making good money. Is it still in effect? Asked the man's voice. I listened. From my lair in the closet, I listened as they kissed. Yes, Laura said finally. The insurance premium is due next month. Matt and I probably won't be able to pay for it after that. But if you and I kill him now, we can still collect the insurance money. We'll be rich, said the man, after we kill him. I couldn't believe my ears. They were planning to murder me. I got down from the clothes pole and slowly opened the door. Got to get away was all I could think. Got to get away from them. I rushed down the stairs and out the door before they could stop me. I heard them talking behind me. It was Matt, Laura cried. He must have heard us. He'll go to the police. I'll stop him, vowed the man. I'll stop him however I have to. Laura's lover came after me. The sidewalks were dark and deserted. I ran, uttering little shrill, high-pitched shrieks. They warned me of fences, dead-end alleys, and blind streets. Laura's lover pounded along after me. Matt, he shouted. It's no use. I'll get you. As I ran, I looked down. Claws sprang from my fingers where nails had once grown. I stared at them in horror. And when I do get you, Matt, the man was yelling, I passed my clawed hand over my face. It was hairy. And over my lower lip hung fangs. I had grown fangs. When I get you, Matt, I'll kill you, the man was shouting. I stopped running. There was no need to run any longer. I knew what I had to do. Laura's lover ran up to me, leering. He thought he had me now. I could tell. I almost felt sorry for the poor sap. But not quite. Then he saw me. His eyes widened in horror. I sprang at him. No, no, keep away, he screamed. When it was over, he lay sprawled grotesquely on the cobblestones, white as chalk. There were two punctures on his neck. He was dead. I had drained his blood. I stood over him, trying to think. I'm not just an ordinary bat, I said to myself. I looked at my long claws, my twisted hands. I felt my fangs jutting down over my lower lip. I'm a vampire bat. I fairly flew back through the streets to my house, back to Laura. Did you get him, Chuck? She began as she heard me come in. Then she saw me. Matt, what's happened to you? I killed him, Laura, I explained. I killed him as you had planned to kill me. And now I must kill you too. No, Matt, no, she screamed. But I wasn't listening. Not anymore. Her throat was white and soft, not like his. When I had finished, I looked around me. Now I've got to go away and hide, I said to myself, wiping the blood off my face with my sleeve. So I found a place, a nice quiet place to hide. It's in a coffin in this lovely mausoleum. And what did I do with the body that occupied it before I came? I brought it to John, my friend. He made short work of it. Well, there you go, kiddies. I guess you can say Matt was going a little batty. Too harsh? I guess that just makes me a little catty, like his friend John. I can't take the credit for that joke, it's at the end of this story, so, anyway, thanks for joining me for tonight's little Fable Fright, and thanks to everyone who has been joining me during the live stream. If you'd like to take part in watching your old pal film an episode, head on over to Instagram and follow me on @OldPalCollector. Don't forget to hit that like and subscribe button to be notified of my next visit into your nightmares. And now, good night out there. Whatever you are.